combination, every move that he makes. One smile and suddenly nobody else will do. You know you'll never be lonely with you, no.
Me. Welcome to Midday. Here we are at 1 o'clock, third day in a new slot. I am Bill Boggs, and if you're one of our new viewers, this is my brown suit. You'll see this a lot. This is one of my big favorites. I wear this all the time. Good to be with you. I was out at Yankee Stadium last night for the Ali-Norton fight, and as we all know, Ali won a controversial, it's going to be disputed, unanimous decision. I'd like to show you what my prediction was. This is Bill's prediction immediately after the show yesterday. I went into my office, tried to zero in on what was going to happen last night at Yankee Stadium, made a prediction, and put it in this envelope. I will now reveal what my prediction was. Come here. This is some of our fine wood-grained embossed Midday no-frills stationery. My prediction was Ali by TKO in the 11th round, which proves that I don't do this kind of work very well. I am not the amazing Kreskin. I missed, totally. I was there last night. Let me tell you what I think, because I'm a fight fan and I have a certain, I think, trained eye in looking at this stuff. It was obviously not Ali's finest hour. Muhammad Ali did not win, but he also did not lose the fight. What he did was essentially, I think, he retained his title in what I think is going to be one of the most controversial bouts in many, many years. Later on today's show, Floyd Patterson, former great heavyweight champion, now a New York State boxing commissioner, is going to be here to discuss it, as well as Leroy Neiman, who has some exclusive drawings to show us. He was right in the ring when Kenny Norton collapsed in tears at this unanimous decision. Kenny Norton just literally fell down crying in the ring. We'll talk about that later on the show. Also today, we're going to have doctors confronting doctors. It's the first of our three debates. Actually, it's Dr. Edgar Berman, who is back again. He's a doctor who wrote the book, The Solid Gold Stethoscope. Today, he's going to be blasting surgeons. We also have a plant doctor with us today, Dr. Jerry Baker, the entrepreneur of manure, will be with us to take a look at what makes plants get sick. But I want to begin today's show by showing you kind of an unusual thing in showbiz. You know that sometimes when the show must go on, it requires making a very fast change. We have with us the fastest change artist in the world. Hi, what's your name?
Jeannie.
Jeannie, and you're the fastest change artist in the world.
Yes.
You're going to be able to just zip behind that flat change and come right out again?
That's right.
All right, may we have some music and see how Jeannie does her stuff. The music, please. Go to it. Let's see what this looks like. The world's fastest change. Unbelievable! Just impossible. I can't believe that. No wonder you're the fastest in the world. Can you do it again?
I sure can.
There's the music. Go ahead one more time. This is amazing. Now, how could this... Could we just try this one more time? I'm astounded by this, really. Jeez, I'm totally baffled by this. Jeannie, you have to explain to me, how do you do this?
That's very simple, Bill. Girls?
Girls? There's a gimmick everywhere. You must be, you are triplets. Come over here for a second, I want to talk to you. Are you Jeannie?
I'm Maureen.
Maureen?
Yes.
Sit here, please. And you're?
Jeannie.
Jeannie?
Hello.
Oh, I remember you. You're the first one.
And I'm Lucille.
Lucille, have a seat and let people get a good look at you. Sit down here on my prediction, if you don't mind.
Can you get through?
Sure, I can get through. Well, triplets, huh? You're the Kane triplets?
Yes.
Is this an act that you do on regular occasions like this?
Yes, we sing. We're singers.
Where are you singing now?
At the Rainbow Grill in Manhattan.
Do you sing collectively or separately?
I guess both.
You know, I wonder about, I'm just a, you know, single child. I didn't have a twin brother or anything. Like, some of the things I want to know about. Growing up, was there a lot of competition among the three of you?
No, there was no competition among the three of us.
Oh, that's impossible.
No, that's true. It really wasn't. We didn't care. Even as far as boys were concerned, as long as one of us got them, we didn't care.
You could all use them then.
That's right, yes.
Get one,
you think
all
we're stupid?
Used by all three. But what, did you have a lot of competition for boyfriends, though? I mean, if one kind of fell in love with you, Did sometimes, if you were not feeling too well, you send your sister out on the date?
I didn't do it, but Jeannie and Lucille did.
You did
yes,
that?
Yes, I did. Lucille got my presents, too.
And you got presents?
I sure did.
Did the guys know what you were doing?
Yeah, he knew the next day.
I don't know what you're doing. How did he know the next day?
I don't know. He just said, how did your sister Lucille like the bracelet I bought her? And I said, oh, thank you. And he said, she's keeping it because I enjoyed her very much.
Are you totally identical from head to toe?
Yes, we are.
It's kind of personal, Bill, don't you think?
You got, these are the questions you have to ask. When you were growing up, did you have the same friends? Or did you have different friends?
We still do. We still have mostly the same friends.
You know? Uh-huh.
If one of us meets someone else, we kind of take him into our little cove and, you know.
And do what?
Well,
I want to know what happens in the cove. The fact that you're triplets, does that mean when you get married and have children that they might be triplets or twins? It's more likely, isn't it?
They say, I don't know, we heard now that our brothers would be most likely to. I don't know.
Uh-huh.
I hope they do, because I don't.
What about the common belief that twins and triplets share the same pains? Like if you have a pain in your side that your sisters do, is that true?
Well, not really, but we all had kidney stones about a year apart. Each one of us, the same side, we had kidney stones. And Jeannie's a hypochondriac, so she's always got a pain, so we'd be in pain, the two of us, all the time if it were Jeannie.
And Maureen is married, right?
Yes, I just got married.
You just got married?
Surprise.
Now, what kind of problems does it confront for your husband to be married to triplets?
He loves it, and so does Harris. They keep making believe they don't know us apart after a while, you know. Oh, honey, I didn't know. I thought it was you, you know, when he kisses you and all.
All right, now, when people say when they get to know you really well, they can tell you apart. Because I once dated twins, and it took a while, but I figured it out. Now, when you are with people and they've known you for years, what do they say they can tell? How can they tell the difference between you two, for example?
Well, you know, I'll tell you the truth, Bill. With all our friends, they feel that once they get to know us, our personalities give us away right away. Our whole character changes, and like our friends don't think we look alike at all.
Not at all?
Not at all.
How are those two the same?
They just don't look alike to me. They really don't. I don't think they look alike at all.
But I mean, in terms of their personality, how are they?
Well, Maureen's the settled one, I guess.
Lucille and I are much closer.
And Jeannie and I are more like we're sort of flaky.
They're the wild ones.
Hasn't it bothered you all your life to be part of a team?
Yes.
I mean, not to have a sense of personal, singular identity?
Yes. Would you like to have an hour and we'll talk about it?
Well, is that really?
Well, no, it's nothing serious. When we were younger, it bothered us because we were so young, we didn't realize why when we'd go out dressed like people would stare and make jokes and tease us and talk to us. We didn't understand. We just wanted to go to a party and enjoy ourselves,
mm-hmm.
you know?
But
so
you
it was hard for us then.
Attention.
We were always the center of attention.
Oh, well, you were going to make it more of the center of attention. You move over here just for a second. Now we have the three of you together. Tell me what the differences are. There have to be differences among the three of you. What are the differences? How are you different than her?
Well, I don't know. I don't know if there's a visual one.
No, in terms of your personalities, just different.
Oh, well, Lucille and I are pretty much the same.
Yeah.
Maureen's much more settled. You know, Maureen's
what does
calm.
That mean, Maureen?
They're trying to make me sound very dull. That's what they mean. No, I don't know. I guess I'm just like the old mother of the group.
She is.
You know,
she
I watch
is.
Over them
She's
all the time.
Boring.
Which one was born first?
I was.
Well, that's the reason.
She is. Motherly instinct.
There's a good reason for that. If you had it to do over again, would you rather have been born just as maybe have two sisters but have them born at different times?
I would want to be born alone.
Then
I don't have to worry about them anymore.
Oh, is it
no,
nice?
I'm teasing. No, I don't know. I don't know what it's like to be anything other than triplets, so I really don't know.
Is it true you were discovered by the McGuire sisters?
Yes, we were.
First
we
worked with them.
First
only
Godfrey.
The multiple acts. They only deal with multiples. All right, you just relax for a second. Gather your... Aren't they cute? I mean, you're really, really attractive young women.
Thank you.
We'll take a break, and we're going to introduce you to three other triplets, which already is redundant, but they're with us, and they're only about this big. You stay with us, and you'll meet them. We'll be right back. Welcome back. We met the Kane triplets disguised as a bogus fast change act. Here's another set of triplets I'd like you to meet. The mother is a lovely woman. Leslie Simon is her name. She has, obviously, two of her three on her lap right now. Her mother, who is the grandmother, Alice Simon, is here with the third. And we welcome you.
Well, thank you.
Jeez, what's it like being the mother of triplets?
Busy.
You literally have your hands full.
Oh, yes. It's quite busy.
When did you first find out that you were going to be the mom of triplets?
I think I was in my fifth month. And I went to the doctor, and I met another girl who just found out she was having twins, and she was thrilled.
She liked that, huh?
Oh, she loved it. I was thinking, I really feel sorry for her. But then I found out maybe a half hour later that I was having triplets after the x-rays.
You don't have to go much further to find somebody who's worse off than you, huh?
I couldn't believe it. First they told me twins, and it took me a while to adjust to that. And at 5 o'clock, I was at work. My doctor called and said, I'm having triplets. And I just laughed. I thought that was ridiculous.
You know, you took a mild fertility drug, I guess, to help facilitate your pregnancy once, and they said it would not create multiple births. Do you feel that you got bad medical advice?
It's hard to say. I don't know of any cases from Clomid that of anybody that had triplets, but it was the mildest dosage. I really don't know the answer. Mm. It's possible the doctor said I was having twins and maybe it could have made it into the third child.
Mm. Well, Grandma, you would have taken five or six, I'm sure.
Five or six what?
Children.
Oh, no. I didn't even want to be a grandmother.
No?
No way.
Why not?
I told Leslie I was cutting out to Europe and she can have her own children. I have mine.
But now you've got the responsibility of grandmother for three.
Oh, yeah, but they can't call me grandmother.
Why not?
It was a shock to have three, so now I'm very proud of it, but...
Does it hurt your ego being called grandmom? Make you feel old?
They're not calling me grandmom. We have a battle all the time.
What are they calling you,
I
aunt?
I hope it's Alice or no Nina, something like that.
No grandmother. How about just great-grandmother?
No, that's... Oh, no, this
would be even worse.
They've got a few great-grandmothers, thank God.
What about your sense of responsibility as a mother of triplets? How do you cope with... just giving them their own identities. Here they are coming into the world. They're still young. They're only 2.5 years old.
I find that it's no problem at all coping with their identity because they're all fraternal. They're three completely different children, and I handle each one differently.
They're not identical as
right, McCain. They're all fraternal.
What advice do you have? Now, here, you've lived through it.
Bill, watching them play around, do you notice that the boys are much closer with each other than with the girl?
No.
You don't notice that?
No. The Adam and Lisa are very close, and David is a little bit apart from them. Like, even when we take them for walks, Adam and Lisa hold hands, and David likes to walk in the back.
What was the time of their birth, though? Was David the oldest? Is David the oldest?
No, the Adam is the oldest, then Lisa, then David.
And what's the span of time that they were born?
Oh, probably a second apart. I had them by cesarean.
Will you be quiet? We have to have a discussion. I have to ask you to be quiet. Now we're on TV. Do you mind? Just be quiet for about a minute. Please.
He wants his mommy.
David had a little accident.
Yeah. He looks like he ran into a 2.5-year-old Ali. He has a little black eye on his face. What happened, pal? Wasn't pleasant, was it?
Why are you crying?
Can't you let him sit over there?
Sure, you want to come sit with me?
Sure, I love lifting little people. It's so cute. You can do anything with them. Lift them high in the air and put them down and everything. Oh, it'll be okay, buddy. You're all right now. What are you going to do about clothing? Are you going to always dress them the same?
No, I usually dress them all different. I've been very fortunate. I have a friend, Dorothy Barham, I believe the last name is, and she's been terrific. She's helped me a lot in giving me clothes for the children, because when I do buy them outfits, when I go to buy them clothes, it doesn't last very long, and I don't have other children to hand them down to.
Mm-hmm. Did you three dress alike when you were...
Yes. We were identical.
I'm so happy you say that you're not going to dress them alike.
I think it's great that you three answer at exactly the same time. I think that's good. I like that. Should we do something because he's a little crying child? Maybe we should remove him. I'll remove him. Here, Grandma. I know you don't like that, Grandma. Just another example of what grandmothers get to do in our society. They get to leave the TV station when the little grandchild is crying. Well, no, let us get back into the the problem of growing up, being triplets, the lack of a sense of identity.
Yeah.
What kind of advice do you give to a mother now who is in the position that your mother was in, you know, several years ago?
Well, the only thing I feel that ever bothered us was the idea that we would dress always constantly alike. You know, where it goes back to the story where we never were just being ourselves. We were always made a spectacle of, you know. And I know.
Why did your mother do that, though? I mean,
well,
if you...
she thought it was cute, and she figured everyone said, oh, they're triplets, you have to dress them alike.
But couldn't you have a caucus? Say, hey, Mom, we have some nude. We want to lay this on you. The kids at school are making fun of us. But it took a long time to do that. Then.
You know, Bill, though, Mom had six others besides us. There's six
other
children.
Sets of triplets?
No.
I thought it was, 21 kids in the family.
Six other children besides us.
Uh-huh.
It was kind of tough telling us what to do and telling them what to do, you know.
Yeah, I see that. But as you get back to your case, you impress me as a woman who is resigned to raising triplets.
Oh, sure. You have to be.
I mean, I know that, but can you share that with us a little bit? I mean, were you actually disappointed? I mean, obviously, you know you love your kids, but were you disappointed?
Oh, no. When I actually, once I gave birth, I'd say the hardest thing for me really was the pregnancy. To me, that was the toughest because I carried full term, and it was very, very painful for me. But once, I'd say the first 3 months, I remember the first day the nurse walked out the door, and I almost had a heart attack. And then I heard 3 screaming babies, and I just got with it, and I started taking care of them. And the biggest saver to me was my friend Dorothy with the triplets told me, she went away for the summer, and her last words to me was, Leslie, blend. And I would blend the bottles of food, and I would make the nipple holes larger, and that's how I would feed them their meals. And the doctor said, that's terrible, you can't do that. They said it wasn't healthy. My kids ate beautifully.
That one's eating his jacket right there. They're very healthy. He's consuming a leisure suit.
They eat
right before your eyes on television.
So that was really my savior, was feeding them through the bottles.
Hmm. We have an equal time situation here. You know, we get involved with some of the politics. Equal time for grandmas. Here is Leslie's mother. The other woman was your mother-in-law. Hello. It's nice to see you. Is it okay to call you grandma?
Very proud. I have 3 other grandchildren.
They're screaming for us to sit down. Now we're seated. Good. You have 3 other children besides.
3 other grandchildren.
3 other grandchildren. What about this set of triplets? How do you feel about them?
Well, I love them naturally.
Of course you love them. Every grandmother in the world loves their children. But what about the fact that your dear daughter now is...
I suffer it as much as she did.
In what way?
Well, I'm a resident of Florida, and I came up to be with her.
That's not quite the same as bearing 3 children, getting on a plane and flying.
She was in bed for a long time, and she went through quite a bit. So we had to learn how to laugh and have a good time together.
What kind of advice have you been giving your dear daughter now that she is the mother of 3 children at once?
Good luck. I'm moving to Florida.
You're going back on the plane and leaving her with the kids.
She's been wonderful.
Well, this is fun, and I appreciate your being with us. I want to remind people that you are the Kane Triplets, and you're performing now at the Rainbow Grill with, who else is up there?
Oh, yes, we have a little lad called the DeMarco family, little children, and they're very cute. I'm sure you'd enjoy
it. So we've got the Kane Triplets and the DeMarco family at the Rainbow. Is there any room in the audience for people?
Yes.
Okay.
Singles, too.
Good. Thank you for being with us. You can retire to the inner sanctums of our Channel 5 studio here and get back together with your other son. Take care. We'll be back with the doctor's debate right after this.
Refuses all comment. But last week, Dole bristled at an article suggesting his organization might have been involved.
We disavowed the ads. I would suggest whoever wrote that article should talk to some of the editors. They'll find out that we didn't authorize the ads.
But files at the offices of the Johnson County Sun in Kansas reveal an authorization for the advertisement, required by law, was signed by Sam Richardson, an employee at Dole's campaign headquarters at the time. The newspaper's associate publisher says Richardson was in his office when the Right to Life people brought in the ad.
He looked at the ad for quite some time, and obviously, like I said, he was in an awkward position. It was difficult to say, you know, this isn't something that we want. All he did was try to relate this to his federal expenditure limit.
And then he said it would be okay to run the ad.
And then he said it would be all right, and he did sign a form which would allow the ad to run.
The former campaign employee, Richardson, admits he signed the form, but says he doesn't remember seeing the ad before he signed.
I did not get involved in the layout of the ad, the text of the ad, anything like that.
Wouldn't you have been alarmed at this ad? I mean, to see the skull and the crossbones?
I didn't see the skull and the crossbones. I was very alarmed, and
Editor there remembers that you looked at the ad. He said a salesman brought it in, and he was concerned about whether they should run it or not, and you were there, and you looked at it.
I don't remember looking at it.
Later, after the ads ran, Senator Dole says he was angry and publicly disavowed the ads. But Kansas reporters don't remember any disavowal, and the only printed evidence is a one-sentence disclaimer near the end of a long release from Dole dealing with a variety of subjects. And the newspaper ads are listed in Dole's official campaign report as a contribution in kind from the Eastern Kansas Right to Life organization. Questioned again about this, Dole now says his staff could have made mistakes, but he wasn't involved.
I guess I'm responsible for what my staff does, even though it may not be total competence. And I really don't know what all the sound and fury is about now. I assume it's to characterize me as a dirty trickster or somehow not credible, but there's not been one scintilla of evidence that Senator Dole authorized any such ad, and there'll be no such evidence.
But the Dole organization's explanation of the 1974 events keeps changing. And now that Dole is running on a national ticket, Dole's opponents can be counted on to keep asking questions. Robert Hager, NBC News, Washington.
If you're buying a car and you haven't driven a Rabbit, you're making a mistake.
Can I try it, Larry?
It has great gas economy and amazing acceleration.
Can I try it, Larry?
It has incredible room inside. And no other car we know of has this combination of gas economy, acceleration, and room for under $3,500. So try to borrow a Rabbit or see a VW dealer. You've got to drive it to believe it.
Laboris. Laboris. Honey, where did you pack the Laboris?
There was no Laboris to pack.
Oh, come on. I had some right before I left.
You went to the dentist right before you left.
You're right. My mouth felt clean and fresh, and my breath, terrific.
More dentists use Laboris than any other mouthwash.
And that's good enough for me.
Me too.
Secretary of State Kissinger, soon to leave for Africa to see what he can accomplish there, spoke in Philadelphia today. He said South Africa's apartheid policy is incompatible with any concept of human dignity. He said the U.S. is now the only country in position to deal with all sides in Southern Africa.
The United States, it's the only country which can speak to all sides in Southern Africa's current conflict. We seek no special place for ourselves, and we thus have an influence that can be important for a peaceful outcome. That position carries with it a great responsibility to promote fair and lasting solutions. Our values, our own self-interest in an Africa that lives in peace and racial harmony, and our abiding commitment to peace and world order permit us no other course.
There was some activity in the crater of a volcano on the island of Guadeloupe, and a lot of people expected the big blow-off. Well, that was yesterday. It did not come, but there are predictions it will. A report from Walter Brunner, a freelance journalist who took these pictures.
This is the volcano La Soufriere. A corps of international scientists has been monitoring its activity for the last 6 weeks, and they say it is ready to erupt at any time. Yesterday, as a group of 12 scientists approached the summit to gather gas and ash for analysis, there was a violent explosion. It showered them with rocks, mud, and superheated water. Six of the men were injured, none seriously. The scientists said the explosion was caused by steam and ash bursting through the crust of the volcano's crater. The explosion was similar to others that have occurred over the last month, but it was not the major eruption that first reports from Guadeloupe had indicated yesterday. Fishermen in the area report that the ocean's floor in some areas around the base of the volcano has risen as much as 45 feet in the last few months, an indication of even more dramatic activity below the Earth's surface. Dominique Rogier, foreign press attaché for the French government, described the situation this morning.
Explosion. We haven't got yet the eruption. We are expecting an eruption at any time of the moment, but the seismic activity is increasing every day. So we may have the eruption tomorrow, as well in 2 weeks or 1 week, or perhaps 1 month.
With 2 hours warning, the most that scientists here can give, all that the inhabitants of this island can do is watch and wait. This is Walter Brunner reporting for NBC News in Guadeloupe.
An engaging scene in Washington today in federal court. Lawyers, consumer organizations, federal and state officials arguing heatedly about what should be allowed inside hot dogs. Specifically, the powdered animal bone that is produced by machines in packing houses removing the meat from the bones. The Agriculture Department says it is all right to include the powdered bone in the hot dogs. The consumer groups say it is not all right. A federal judge heard these arguments and said he would rule tomorrow on whether or not we are to have bone dogs. Thank you and good night for NBC News.
You're about to see a test of strength. We're gluing these beams together with Elmer's glue-all. No nails, no bolts.
Will the Elmers hold? Let's see. Look, the Elmers held. Elmers was stronger than the wood itself, stronger than you'll ever need for most household jobs.
Elmers, America's favorite glue.
Mazola Margarine says, think before you eat. Think about all the goodness in Mazola Margarine. Think of Mazola's light, creamy taste. Think the goodness of Mazola Margarine's golden corn oil. And Mazola has no cholesterol. Think of it as part of a plan to restrict fats and cholesterol. Think about what you want in margarine. You'll find it in Mazola Margarine. Think about it.
Meet Tom Brokaw, newsman for Today. You've heard him on NBC Nightly News and at the conventions. As White House correspondent, now he begins a new assignment, host of Today. Join Tom Brokaw on Today, weekdays at 7 on NBC.
Get the best for your car and pay less. You can at Two Guys. Here's a terrific value on a Lee oil filter, the do-it-yourself leader. Now a super low 157 buys you a Lee oil filter at Two Guys. Save, too, on famous Castrol GTX, the finest lubrication for any car. Two Guys low price, just 59 cents a quart for Castrol GTX. You'll find the best automotive buys at Two Guys, naturally.
People always ask me what I do to make my chickens taste so good. I do my best.
Wild Kingdom is next.
Mutual of Omaha's Wild Kingdom is presented by Mutual of Omaha, people you can count on.
Hello, welcome to Mutual of Omaha's Wild Kingdom. Our story today is about an exciting adventure we had exploring Jaguar Country. Some of you may remember that earlier this year, Jim and I went to Mexico to capture a cattle-killing jaguar and her cub. We took them away from the ranch lands and set them free in a new area, a place we call Jaguar Country.
This part of northern Mexico where they were resettled is a fascinating area. It's the home, not only of the jaguar, but of the many little-known cats like the cockamissal and the jaguarundi. There are poisonous lizards here and deadly rattlesnakes and strange birds who kill those rattlers. It's one of the most interesting corners of the wild kingdom you could explore.
We returned to Jaguar Country to see if our jaguar had established herself there in the new area, or if she'd gone back to her old home in the cattle country. We set up camp on the bank of the same river where a few months earlier we had released the big cat and her cub. It's harsh, deserted, dry country, with this river the only water for miles around. A primitive place where the stillness is broken by the lonely howl of a coyote. The coyote's cry seems to echo our own feeling of isolation.
In the time we've been here, we've gotten to know some of the animals that come down to the river. There's a Quatamundi, one of a small band we've seen before. They eat anything from juicy grubs to lizards. The Quatamundi is the South American cousin of our raccoons. The Quatamundi's coat is coarser than the raccoon, and his tail's longer and more slender. But he's just as bright and agile. Unlike the more independent raccoon, the Quatamundi prefers to live and hunt in bands.
They leave. And it's time for us to continue our search for the jaguar and her cub. For 6 days now, we've searched this area, but without success. There's one place we have not explored,